In this video, we're going to take a look at message brokers, represented by RabbitMQ and Apache Kafka. So far, we've dealt with various communication methods between computers connected via a network while dealing with API-related topics. All these methods involved one side delivering a message directly and synchronously to the other. By synchronous, it means that when one side sends a message, the other side receives it then and there. It means that, like a walkie-talkie, one side needs to be listening when the other side is talking, and the sender needs to care if the receiver is getting the message. If the server is down or has an overload issue, when the client sends data, the data may not be successfully sent and can be lost. Additionally, in the microservices architecture, there are many cases where one side needs to send data to multiple targets. In the case of social networks, the service in charge of user posts needs to notify the services handling feed updates, notifications, statistics, and logs every time a new post is uploaded. All of these must be able to send and receive, and all transmissions must be successful. If the data required by the recipient is different, implementation can become complex, and if the recipient service is added or changed, the sender also must be able to respond accordingly. Things can get very complex if there are multiple senders. When services that handle following, messaging, profile modifications, etc. are added, the architecture becomes more complex to manage and more susceptible to minor issues. The topic of this video, the message broker system, liberates the sender and the receiver from each other. This is achieved by placing a message broker, a kind of mailbox, between them. In the system, the sending party is called a producer, and the receiving party is a consumer. Now, whenever the producer has something to deliver, all it has to do is leave the data in this mailbox. The producer can focus on its work without worrying at all about whether the consumer has received it. The consumer searches this mailbox whenever possible and finds the necessary data. Since the mailbox has partitions by type, each consumer only needs to pick out what they need. Because the mailbox retains received data until a specified time, there's no worry about data loss, even if the consumer doesn't immediately find it. Even if the number of producers and consumers increases, all transmissions are made through this mailbox or message broker, making the design easier. Thus, by using a mailbox method, not a walkie-talkie-like method, the message broker flexibly facilitates communication between senders and receivers, prevents loss of data, and facilitates horizontal expansion. Therefore, services that require safe message delivery, independence between nodes, and scalability over quick response. For instance, email, log collection, online payment, image processing, microservices, etc. are very effectively utilized. On the other hand, message brokers may not be suitable when the immediate responses to requests are necessary within a relatively simple system. If you search for message broker, you can find more than a dozen products. These products are usually divided into two categories, and the criteria and terminology of each category are also diverse, like this. Since the most representative product in the left category is usually RabbitMQ, and the most famous in the right is Kafka. In this video, we will understand the two approaches of message broker by comparing RabbitMQ and Kafka.
What MQ?
It's RabbitMQ and Kafka. This is just a comparison of the representative products of each category. Remember that all products have their own unique characteristics and functions. Now, let's look at their detailed operational mechanism. A message broker runs on a server separate from the producer and consumer. Developers can either set up their own servers and operate by installing RabbitMQ or Kafka, or they can use services provided by cloud companies like AWS, Azure, Google Cloud Platform. For example, you can see that AWS provides services like RabbitMQ and Kafka. For reasons we'll discuss later, RabbitMQ is installed on one or relatively few servers, while Kafka is typically operated on a large-scale cluster. The producer and consumer also have RabbitMQ or Kafka clients installed to communicate with the broker server in the middle. In case of RabbitMQ, communication between the producer and message broker and the message broker and consumer mainly uses a protocol called AMQP. Kafka uses its own protocol based on TCP. The part I'm going to talk about now is an important difference between RabbitMQ and Kafka. How they handle messages will be the key criteria for you to choose from between these two products. RabbitMQ stores messages in a queue form, while Kafka does so in a log form. First, let's take a look at how RabbitMQ operates. As is well known, a queue follows the principle of first in, first out. That is, what comes in first goes out first. The RabbitMQ broker stores these messages in a queue format in the order sent by the producer. And when the consumers request them, it transmits them, taking them out of the queue. In other words, in RabbitMQ, the broker is not only responsible for obtaining and storing messages from the producer, but also for removing them from the queue every time a consumer retrieves a message. On the other hand, all the consumer needs to do is to request messages from the broker without considering anything else. This approach is often described as smart broker, dumb consumer. In RabbitMQ, messages are mainly stored in memory, so processing is fast, but there is a risk of loss. In contrast, Kafka stores messages on the disk in the form of logs. These messages are not erased from the log, even if the consumer takes them. Just like elements in an array have their own indices, messages within the log also have their offsets. So by consumers remembering the last offset they took, they can request the next message without duplication. In other words, this approach is like the dumb broker, smart consumer. Therefore, in this approach, implementing a consumer can be more complex than with RabbitMQ. However, for brokers, the burden is reduced as there is no need to perform tasks according to the consumer's request, and it is safe from loss because messages are stored on disk. Depending on the need, a consumer can receive a specific message multiple times. In case of a failure, it can start receiving right from the point where there was an issue. Although the disk is slower than memory, if you store sequentially like Kafka, you can maximize performance. Kafka essentially provides a batch function, so it's quicker and simpler to receive or send multiple messages than RabbitMQ. Above all, Kafka's method is more favorable for clustering, where brokers are distributed and operated on multiple servers. Because consumers use offsets to access messages, each node only needs to synchronize the received messages on time. In contrast, in RabbitMQ, clustering is tricky because the messages consumed by consumers need to be deleted and applied in real time to other nodes. Due to these factors, products like Kafka are advantageous for large-scale real-time streaming, data pipelines, and log aggregation and analysis, which require high throughput of distributed systems.
I don't know why, but I feel very angry.
However, products like RabbitMQ also have their own strengths. First, RabbitMQ supports a work queue that allows multiple workers to distribute processing tasks that take time. Workers located at the consumer's location can take one task at a time and send a signal to the broker to remove the message as soon as the task is completed. Therefore, it can be used effectively in services that receive multiple image files and provide graphic processing. Also, RabbitMQ has a more diverse way of delivering messages via specific categories. In Kafka, messages can be grouped into a group called a topic, while in RabbitMQ, messages can be grouped into a group called a queue. Because RabbitMQ provides various ways to send each message to a specific queue or to all queues according to conditions, it is more advantageous than Kafka in services that require complex message routing. Moreover, RabbitMQ can guarantee reliable delivery by communicating the successful processing of messages to the broker. This method is suitable for tasks that require stable processing, like transactions, because the broker can check whether the messages have been processed. Functions such as prioritizing messages and setting them to expire automatically after a certain time are also standard features in RabbitMQ. When taking into account these factors, we can give the following examples of services for which RabbitMQ and Kafka are each suitable. However, please remember, this could vary depending on each implementation, so it shouldn't be an absolute standard. Also, in this video, I've only showcased features that are good for understanding the differences between RabbitMQ and Kafka. There are many more powerful features in each product, and you can check detailed guides on their official pages. Up until this video, we have explored various types of APIs that are widely used. From the next video, we will cover a few topics related to front-end development. Then, I'll see you in the next video.